Hello, and welcome to Folger Encores. I'm Gigi Bradford, the chair of the Folger Poetry Board, and I'm happy to speak to you today. The Folger has been sharing selections with you from their plays, music, readings, and talks in this Encores series. This week, we're looking at Shakespeare's sisters, Women Writers Bridge Five Centuries, a book, reading, and exhibition inspired by the course for high school students developed by Louisa Newlin in consultation with the Folger Poetry and Education departments. Louisa named the course Shakespeare's Sisters, and our 2012 exhibition was developed from this initiative. The title, Shakespeare's Sisters, is inspired in part by an essay by Virginia Woolf. In a room of one's own, Woolf imagined a sister for Shakespeare called Judith. She wanted to be a playwright like her brother, but was unable to pursue a career as a professional writer because of her gender. Alongside the exhibition and the course that is still being taught at the Folger, we created a limited edition hand-bound chapbook where contemporary writers responded to newly discovered works by 16th and 17th century women writers. Among the 13 prominent women poets and authors who were part of this book were former US Poets Laureate Maxine Cumin and Rita Dove, who also won the Pulitzer Prize in Poetry, Maryland Poet Laureate Linda Pastan, and Pulitzer Prize winning novelist Jane Smiley. We brought many of these writers together at the Folger to read from their work. And here you will listen to Rita Dove reading the poem we commissioned for the Shakespeare Sisters chapbook, as well as other poems of her own. Rita has been a longtime friend of the Folger, reading her poetry many times in our Elizabethan theater, always gracefully combining the personal and the cultural, which she does here so well across the centuries. We hope that you will enjoy hearing Rita Dove, and please be sure to join us again for these weekly episodes of Encores, highlighting all that the Folger has to offer. Thank you.
Rita, you use a poem written by Elizabeth I, Woodstock, the window poem, yes, as the epigraph, and then write about her scratching this poem on a window with her diamond when she was imprisoned by her sister and rival for the throne. I have the sense that you found it fascinating to think of someone who became queen finding expression not through politics but through poetry. And I thought that might be really good right now for the primaries. So can you tell us a little bit about how you got to the poem?
Well, I was immediately taken by the fact that here was a woman who had, by all accounts, a fantastic education, which was unusual, and had the access to power. And she was imprisoned at the age of 19, with no recourse, no way to express what she was feeling, except through very few words scratched indelibly by what she had at her disposal. It happened to be a diamond. Most of us don't have that. But she used what she had. And in a certain way, I felt that poetry was, for her, the way to present in the most condensed and even coded way possible the very the roilings of her soul. And so in my poem and my response, or my joining into the conversation with Elizabeth I, I imagine her speaking and scratching a kind of companion poem, as I say, on the body politic, but somehow inside of her, because she realized at a very young age that she was not only a human being, but she had the potential to be the body politic, to be the entire of England, and that double consciousness followed her all her life. So here we have Elizabeth I, the Lodge at Woodstock in 1554, taking account of what she has and what she does and what counts, what really matters or not. It's a sonnet, which seemed appropriate for the age. Lines composed on the body politic and accounting. The two lines that were scratched on the window were, "Much suspected by me, nothing proved can be," quoth Elizabeth, prisoner. Less than the charting of each dawn's resolutions, less than each evening's trickle of doubt, less than a crown's weight in silver, a diamond's scratch against glass, less than the touted ill luck of my rich beginnings, and yet more than Eve's silence, my mute ingratitude, more than music's safe passage, its rapturous net, more than the stockpile of words, their liquid solicitude, more desired than praise, the least prized of my dreams, less real than dreaming, castle keep for my sins, more than no more, which seems much less than hoped for again. One mutiny quelled, one wish lost, a forgotten treasure, to live without scrutiny, beyond constant measure. Always watched, and yet no one bothered to think about what she felt like inside. We were all asked to read for 10 minutes, and my poem was very short, so that means that I can move on a bit. I thought to read poems which dealt with that whole idea of being without constant measure and also other women. And this poem came from my book, American Smooth, different kinds of sisters. These are actual sisters, a whole group of great aunts, the maiden aunts that never get married. The Sisters, Swan Song. We died one by one, each plumper than the mirror saw us. We exited obligingly, rattling keychains and cocktail jewelry, rehearsing our ghostly encores. Glad to be rid of pin curls and prayers, bunions burning between iron sheets, we sang our laments, praised God, and went our way quietly. Were mourned in satin and chrysanthemums, whiskey and cake, old gossip evaporating into cautionary tales. Does it matter who went first, Corinna or Fay, heartache or coronary, a reckless scalpel or a careless life? Whoever was left kept count on the dwindling rosary, Susanna, Kit, Mary, Violet, Pearl. We all died of insignificance. Because the Oscars are coming up, I thought it appropriate to read this poem, which is about the first African-American woman who got an Oscar for supporting actress in Gone with the Wind, and that was Hattie McDaniel, who got her Oscar for playing the maid in Gone with the Wind. She was reviled on all sides. Some felt she shouldn't have played maid roles of a maid as if there were anything else available to her. And then there were others who did not want to see an African-American get this kind of award. If you ever go back and look at all of the roles that Hattie McDaniel played, all of those maids' names appear in this poem as well. She was never a quiet maid. There was always a flash to the eye. And that time, it was 1939, the Oscars were held at the Coconut Grove, and all of the actors and the producers, everything, would exit their automobiles about a block before and then take that long gauntlet through the paparazzi and fans. Hattie McDaniel arrives at the Coconut Grove late, in aqua and ermine, gardenias scaling her left sleeve in a spasm of scent, her gloves white, her smile chastened, purse giddy with stars and rhinestones clipped to her brilliantined hair, on her free arm that fine Negro, Mr. Wonderful Smith. It's the day that isn't, February 29th at the end of the shortest month of the year, and the shittiest too, everywhere except Hollywood, California, where the maid can wear mink and still be a maid, bobbing her bandaged head and cursing the white folks under her breath as she smiles and shoos their silly daughters in from the night dew. What can she be thinking of, striding into the ballroom where no black face has ever showed itself except above a serving tray? High Hat Hattie, Mama Mac, her haughtiness, the little lady from Showboat whose name Bing forgot, Beulah and Bertha and Melina and Carrie and Violet and Cynthia and Fidelia, one half of the dark Barrymores. Dear Mammy, we can't help but hug you, crawl into your generous lap, tease you with arch innuendo so we can feel that much more wicked and youthful and sleek. But oh, what we forgot. The four husbands, the phantom pregnancy, your famous parties, your celebrated icebox cake, your giggle above the red petticoats rustle, black girl and white girl walking hand in hand down the railroad tracks in Kansas City, 6 years old. The man who advised you, now that you were famous, to begin eliminating your more common acquaintances, and your reply, catching him square in the eye, "That's a good idea. I'll start right now by eliminating you." Is she or isn't she? 3 million dishes, a truckload of aprons and head rags later, and here you are, poised between husbands and factions, no corset wide enough to hold you in, your huge face a dark moon split by that spontaneous smile, your trademark, your curse. No matter, Hattie. It's a long, beautiful walk into that flower-smothered standing ovation. So go on and make them wait.
I've always loved that one.
Thank you. Thank you. My daughter, who is now 29, when she was teeny, when she was 4 or 5, had a running monologue in which she said that nobody loved her but the spring cricket. We don't know where this came cricket from, but she said it for many, many years, and so I'm starting to write the spring cricket poems. But here's one. It's called "The Spring Cricket Considers the Question of Negritude." I was playing my tunes all by myself. I didn't know anyone else who could play along. Sure, the tunes were sad, but sweet, too, and wouldn't come until the day gave out. You know that way the sky has of dangling her last bright wisps? That's when the ache would bloom inside until I couldn't wait. I knelt down to scrape myself clean and didn't care who heard. Then came the shouts and whistles, the roundup into jars, a clamber of legs. Now there were others, tumbled, clouded. I didn't know their names. We were a musical lantern. Children slept through our rasping sighs. And if now and then one of us shook free and sang as he climbed to the brim, he would always fall again, which made them laugh and clap their hands. At least then we knew what pleased them and where the brink was. And I will end with a poem that was inspired by one of my students who started a magazine, an online magazine, and asked if I had a poem, a prose poem. And I told him I wasn't sure if I believed in the prose poem. And he just looked at me, and I thought, yeah, you're right. I need to step up to this plate as well. So I wrote this poem for him. It's called Prose in a Small Space. I must say, first, a small disclaimer that I love prose, and I love writing it as well. It's just another music. But this poem is in three paragraphs or something like that. Prose in a Small Space. It's supposed to be prose if it runs on and on, isn't it? All those words, too many to fall into rank and file, stumbling bare-ass drunk onto the field reporting for duty, yes, sir, spilling out as shamelessly as the glut from a mega-billion-dollar chemical facility. Just the right amount of glittering effluvium it takes to transport a little girl across a room. Beige carpet thick under her Oxfords, curtain blousy with spring. Is that the scent of daffodils drifting in? Daffodils don't smell, but prose doesn't care. Prose likes to hear itself talk. Prose's development and denouement, anticipation hovering near the canopies, lust rampant in the antipasta. For example, a silver fork fingered sadly as the heroine crumples a linen napkin in her lap to keep from crying out at the sight of Lord Campion's regal brow inclined tenderly toward the wealthy young widow. Prose applauds such syntactical dalliances. Then is it poetry if it's confined? Trembling along its axis, a flagpole come alive in high wind, flapping its radiant sleeve for attention. Over here, it's me. While the white spaces, air, field, early morning silence before the school bell, shape themselves around that one bright seizure. And if that's so, what do we have here? A dream or three paragraphs? We have white space too. Is this music? As for all the words left out, banging at the gates, we could let them in, but where would we go with our orders, our stuttering pride?